Welcome to the Resurgence of Science Fiction panel. I'm Petra Mayer with NPR Books, and we have here, not remotely in order because my notes aren't matching the order that they're sitting in, but I'll give it a try. This is Jason Hough. He's the New York Times bestselling author of The Dire Earth Cycle, starting with The Darwin Elevator. His next book, which comes out next month, is a near future spy thriller called Zero World. You can see it here. Jason was born in Illinois, but grew up on the mean streets of suburban San Diego. And when he was 6 years old, his parents took him to see Star Wars. The rest is history.
That's right.
Next to him, we have Chris Weitz. He's an Oscar-nominated writer and director. His films include Twilight, New Moon, A Better Life, About a Boy, The Golden Compass, and American Pie. The Young World is his first YA trilogy. The latest installment is The New Order, which will be out later this month. Who's over there? Hi, this is Peter Clines. He spent his years toiling in the Hollywood trenches, working on movies and shows like Veronica Mars, Psycho Beach Party, and Mystery Woman, before finally turning his hand to writing fiction full-time. He's the author of the best-selling X-Heroes series and the standalone thriller 14. His new book is The Fold, and I think that's out now. Over there, we have Adam Christopher. He's a novelist and comic writer. His debut novel, Empire State, was Sci-Fi Now's Book of the Year and a Financial Times Book of the Year in 2012. His next, Made to Kill, is out in November. It's book one of a trilogy set in the 1960s in Hollywood, starring a robot detective and his supercomputer girl, Friday. And next to him is Mel Odom, who's written more than 140 books in every possible genre, from action adventure to high fantasy. He's also written original novels for popular shows like Buffy the Vampire Slayer and Roswell, and for games like Shadowrun and Forgotten Realms. His latest is the military sci-fi thriller Master Sergeant, which I'm reading right now. And all the way on the end is Margaret Stohl.
Oh my gosh, I'm so bored. You gotta woo more. I can't handle it. My ADD is kicking in.
She's the best-selling author of the Caster Chronicle series, beginning with Beautiful Creatures, which was made into a movie in 2013.
I'm not above a woo.
She's taught poetry and film studies, designed video games, went to my alma mater, Amherst. Hello. And her new book is Black Widow, Forever Red.
So welcome to our wonderful panel. It's fake. I'm just going to tell you that.
So
You were at Amherst?
Oh.
You were at Amherst?
Yes. Gosh, are there a bunch of us here?
Through snowballs at you.
Oh, found it. That's awesome. At least you weren't the Lord Jeffs.
Don't get me started. Anyways, the description on this panel says, "Welcome to the promised land, oh geeks and nerds, your time has come," which I thought was kind of obvious just looking around. Our time has come. But it's true. I mean, you only really have to look out your window right now to see some really exciting stuff. I personally got a little bit wibbly walking down Fifth Street and seeing that sci-fi has a whole Expanse-themed restaurant. Major publishing houses are starting genre imprints. Even very nutritious NPR-approved authors, I will name no names, are trying their hand at genre fiction, sometimes quite successfully. So it's a really great time to be a geek, a fangirl, a fanboy, and we have this wonderful panel of people here to discuss it with us. So I wanted to sort of start off, in no particular order, to just ask you all this general question. As a books journalist, I see a lot of trends. One thing that's been hot for a couple of years is dystopia, but it's kind of one facet of a larger phenomenon. So I think the first thing I want to ask you is, why now? Why has our time come? Is it a generational thing? Is it that a generation of people who grew up on video games and comics in the 80s are now running the show? Is it a reflection of what's going on in the world? Because we all know that sci-fi and fantasy is a great way to comment on what's going on in the world in an indirect way. So, in no particular order, what are your thoughts?
Well, since I'm the worst behaved, I'll just jump right in. I was talking to a friend of mine about this who actually works on a luchador television show, which is like, who doesn't want to work on a luchador television show? I was smitten. But he said that if you look through television in particular, it's a really interesting like media study that said, in the last few years, when streaming video really came in, there was a 90% drop in freshmen who brought televisions to college, speaking of college. And I think it was like this one moment where, because the platforms changed in terms of popular culture, there was just a lot of access to alternative programming and things that maybe wouldn't have made it, kind of what cable did before. So while that doesn't necessarily directly impact the book market, it kind of does, because I've had screenwriter friends come to my house and say, we want to pitch this idea. Do you have a sci-fi novel that matches it? because the studio wants to buy a known property. And, you know, like, weird reverse, like, book-driven marketing. So I definitely have started to notice it in the last, I would say, 6 years, like, taking off. That's my take. Woo!
So streaming, you would say that streaming video has made, sort of, has dropped the bar for getting cool ideas out to a general public.
Just more content, the diversity of content, the sort of shattering of a uniform media control where you suddenly just had wackier niche access. Because we're like a niche world.
Not anymore.
No, but that's where we grew.
Part of what I think has changed has been the fact that we're offering science fiction worlds now instead of just science fiction tech or science fiction texturing.
Yeah.
Because if you look at a lot of, I don't know if anybody's seen the new television show they got this summer, Killjoys, the intergalactic bounty hunter thing that's going on, one person. A few of
two.
You
guys, two. Okay, two. They're
three.
Shy.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Three. Back there.
Four. Do I have four?
Secretly,
okay.
they all
know. So anyway, well, one of the things that's going on with that show, if you've seen it, I'm three episodes into it, and they're starting to build a world where there's going to be a political upheaval, there's going to be drawing lines, people are going to have to choose, and instead of just jumping in and going, here's the good guys, here's the bad guys, we're being led along into a real world. And I think, finally, you know, some of the science fiction that's coming out is reflecting those real world choices that a lot of us have to make. And you know, the political atmosphere we've had here in the United States has had people on, you know, there's all kinds of things that are happening. People are having to make choices. Before, science fiction was just, here's your whiz-bang, enjoy. But now you're actually having some thinking science fiction come along. James S.A. Corey's Expanse, which is going to be debuting next season, next summer, is also going to be a very large world to step into, very large worlds to step into. So I think that's the attraction for science fiction, too.
Anybody else want to chime in?
Yeah. Sorry.
No, please.
I was saying you had a really good point actually before about people, sort of children of the 80s, like myself, who are now kind of grown up and running everything. You get resurgence of things like Doctor Who, which was, you know, gone for, I can't remember how many years, nearly 20 years.
19, to be exact.
I'm sorry.
Who's counting? Me, I'm counting.
Yeah, and like, I remember, you know, growing up in the 80s in New Zealand, watching 70s and 80s American sci-fi TV, like taking it so seriously. This was like my whole life. And then, you know, you get to the point where it all comes back because we're now kind of old and writing it ourselves because it's what we love. And I mean, Doctor Who's a really great example. I mean, I'm a huge Doctor Who fan. And then it went away, and then suddenly it came back because people are like, okay, let's make it again.
I think a lot of it is that with movies, sci-fi is hitting a gigantic audience now. We had a big resurgence of fantasy right around the 90s, 2000, with Lord of the Rings and Harry Potter. And I really think, you know, not to kiss ass at Comic-Con, but I think it was superhero movies that brought it around when suddenly we had Batman Begins, which was a very hard, realistic look at a crime fighter, and then Iron Man, which is just straight sci-fi. And those just hit such a gigantic audience and brought sci-fi back into the mainstream in a huge way, huge, very profitable way. So,
I'm going to go into Peter's point a bit and say that it's about computers, which were, when computing power became great enough to render CG effects, I think that meant that the portal to the mainstream, which was the screen, made it into such a huge deal. And even before that, because if you look at Star Wars, part of the strength of that was that for the first time they pulled off effects that didn't look incredibly stupid. That is, well, actually, in a way, they're the same techniques that have been developed for 2001 Space Odyssey, but they were brought to a blockbuster level. And that's about computers too, actually, because although they were done with models, the cameras that were able to do these multiple passes that made them look good were computer controlled. That was early industrial light and magic stuff. So I think there's a technological aspect to it, whereby for the first time you're able to present these fantasy and science fiction worlds in such an immersive and believable fashion that ideas which we knew were cool when we were little kids from reading the books were suddenly visibly cool, which they always would have been, to John Q. Public. I think that's a huge part of it.
I guess my feeling is that that a lot of us, sort of current crop of content creators, are coming out of a a time when we've spent maybe half our lives or more with the internet as a prevalent and just part of everybody's lives, not just us, but fans as well. And so I think it's made the world smaller. It's made it easier for fans to communicate. When I was a kid in the 80s, it was almost impossible for me to find someone who was in the things I was into. There was maybe two or three other kids at school that I could talk to about, you know, Shannara or something like that. And now it's so easy to find fans and embrace what you're fans of. Yeah. And so I think we're also creating content in that sort of in that world, and it's affecting how we write and what we write about.
I actually want to sort of play on that comment a little bit, because this is where I have to admit to something slightly embarrassing. I don't know about you guys, but deep inside me, I do have an inner comic book guy. I have an inner gatekeeper. And to an inner hipster, I guess. And to that inner hipster, this whole phenomenon is kind of bittersweet. What has it been for you, the experience of something that was once sort of very special to us, to the people in this room? You know, I was passing Pern books around with my friends in fourth grade and begging my mom to use the Betamax to tape old Trek, the one true Trek. I will fight you. And suddenly, every 11-year-old in America is wearing a fez and a bow tie. Yeah. And on a 95% of me is going, yes, and 5% of me is going, I'm not special anymore.
Yeah.
What do you guys think? Is that something you felt?
Well, I definitely think in nerd culture, we're like, is nothing left to the nerds? Can you not all back off mainstream world? Can we have nothing? But I do think that, my kids grew up with a poster of Dune, the best and worst movie of all time, on our bathroom wall. You know, they can all recite the litany. I mean, that was like mandatory. That was religion in my current family growing up. And whereas that was like a radical thing happening, as you were saying. One thing I would say is that there was no, for teen fiction, there really was no young adult fiction, which is, by the way, where I work, when we were growing up. That didn't exist. You read sci-fi. So we all switched over from kid books to Ender's Game, which had three swear words in it. It was super exciting. And that was like, you know, that was like the big deal. So we have like super enshrined places, you know, like you're saying about video games. And I would be surprised to know, I think I made video games for 16 years. I bet every single person here is either deeply impacted by a video game or made them. Because I do think you're right, Chris. I think that, or whoever said that, that was part of the deal. Yeah. Definitely like physically building worlds is one of the ways I learned how to build worlds. But yes, it's sad that the niche allure is over, but fandoms have grown. The fandoms have grown our worlds and our ability to kind of live in them. And I, for one, appreciate being able to see a Marvel TV show that's in the same universe as the Marvel movie that, okay, maybe doesn't correlate with the comic books all that, you know, all the time. But, like, I like living in that world. I like having more.
Yeah. Well, when I was growing up, because I'm really old, well, not actually really old, but I read very old. Andre Norton and Robert A. Heinlein were the people I read growing up. And I've got a 17-year-old that's here with us today. He's my keeper for me. But I tried to get Chandler turned on to Andre Norton and Robert A. Heinlein, and he goes, this stuff is just old. And I was like, no, it's not. And so I went back and tried to read it. And God, it's really old, because there's no special effects. Because he grew up on Mass Effect and on Halo. You can't compete with that, with the stuff that we had. The Big Bang Theory is another thing that's really brought science fiction into our fold, and, you know, the whole science fiction and fantasy, because, you know, Sheldon wears comic book t-shirts all the time. I work at the University of Oklahoma and teach writing classes, and I wear, you know, comic book t-shirts all the time. It's my warning sign for people who are normal to stay away. And it works. But we get on there and go, hey, there's Sheldon's wearing a shirt. I've got that one. So I've got a shirt nearly like every episode. And my son, who's 17 now, I'm going to be 18 soon, I started dressing him a superhero t-shirt since he was a kid. And that's all he wears now. And it's by choice, because I no longer dress him or brush his hair. Or.
Oh, come on, admit it. You're among friends.
I think actually this kind of research, well, this acceptance of geek culture into the mainstream is actually good for us as well, because, like, I'm a fan before I'm a writer or anything like that.
Right.
And, yeah, I'm a huge fan of things like Flash and The Arrow, and, like, I was watching The Flash, and it's like, never in my wildest dreams would I imagine seeing The Flash fight Captain Cold and the Reverse Flash on TV, on
or
mainstream.
Gorilla
right. Or Gorilla Grodd. This is like beyond my childhood expectations. So I think, you know, the fact that, I mean, superheroes is kind of like a whole subgenre of its own, of science fiction. But the fact that people love this now, it's like, it's amazing. And yeah, okay, there's that kind of 5% hipster factor of, you know, I like to be first. But that's really just nonsense. I mean, people love it and enjoy it and embrace it. And I think that's amazing. I mean, look at this. It's like, this is my first time at Comic-Con. And it's just like, this is fantastic.
Yeah, I think, I mean, I never felt special growing up because I was, you know, like Jason, one of three kids in my entire high school who liked this sort of stuff, and now I don't feel special because everybody likes it.
So do you feel special?
No, not at all. But yeah, I think it is special. Just great to find, I think, like Chris was saying about effects, it's just we've hit a bump, and now, for a long time, I think a lot of people weren't able to accept sci-fi because sci-fi was people wrapped in tinfoil, and it was film scratch lasers, and, you know, stuff like that. And now, you know, Doctor Who used to be the biggest joke, that if you were a sci-fi fan and you like Doctor Who, where, come on, I mean, look at those monsters. And now it's arguably the second or third biggest sci-fi franchise in the world. And everybody loves it. So, I don't know. I don't really have an inner comic book guy. I just think it's awesome. Yeah. I just love seeing all this stuff. I love seeing the new takes on stuff. I love Gorilla Grodd. I love Deathlock. I love The Flash. I'm loving everything Marvel's doing in DC, and I'm loving that it's encouraging more people to make stuff. So, and more people to read my stuff. So,
you all are better people than me. Did anybody else want to chime in?
I mean, go ahead.
I think part of the fun of this resurgence is enjoying your inner comic book guy. That's
mine's actually a girl.
Fair enough.
Just going to put that out there.
But I think it's a good thing. I think that the reason that a lot of us got into fantasy and sci-fi and comic books is that we didn't feel quite right, or that things were quite right and you could imagine something better. And that, to me, is the nature of fantasy and sci-fi. Or you're imagining something worse, which you're heading towards, which you want to prevent. So I think, in as much as that's a sort of a mindset, it's good for it to be spread around a bit.
Yeah, I think I just wanted to add to Peter's comment that the only thing that I maybe feel less excited about these days is all the reboots and stuff that happen. I love it when brand new things come out of nowhere, like Orphan Black, for example. It just blows me away. And so I'd love to see more new stuff, I guess.
Yeah. By the way, speaking of fandoms, I think I saw the 10th Doctor come in the back somewhere. You came for me, right? Me? Mm-hmm. Yeah? Okay. I want to ask...
if I could, Petra. The new stuff that you're talking about is really good, but we've also had a resurgence of old stuff, old science fiction.
Yeah.
Penny Dreadful. I mean, you know, Penny Dreadful is just absolutely amazing right now. So.
Yeah. No, but I would like to hear that before the end. Like Martian Time Slip, I'd love to see that someday. That was like the book that impacted me the most growing up, and don't read it as a 13-year-old or 14-year-old. It does weird things to you. But The Moon is a Harsh Mistress. You know, there's like books I have that I have imagined the whole book, and I think that's important. I'd love to hear yours by the end.
Actually, if I could bounce off Jason, one thing I think is amazing is sci-fi has become so prevalent with something like Orphan Black or Person of Interest, if anyone watches that.
Oh, yeah.
These are shows we don't even think of as sci-fi shows. I mean, the sheer fact that we have a fantastically popular show about clones and one about artificial intelligence, and we just sort of gloss over that fact with, oh, but who's Helena going to kill this week?
But on the other hand, that's also, like, in my house, and granted we have a nerd family, my husband builds robots that fight our cats. We have the robot v cat ongoing war. Spoiler, the cats are winning. I don't know how. They've learned to go up one step. But that's my real life house. You know what I mean? We have drones, and the big talk is, how can you fly a drone in Santa Monica? Well, you can't. But like, that's my children growing up, that's just life, and I find that fascinating. That's the way it rolls forward.
Which makes me kind of wonder, now that we are living in this wonderful future, the future is here, we just don't have jetpacks. When did you notice that this was happening? What was the tipping point? I think for me, it was the time that I had to spend half an hour teaching my dad how to pronounce Khaleesi, because he'd gotten hooked on Game of Thrones, and he didn't understand that that wasn't her name. But there must be a tipping point when you noticed, my God, we've won.
I think for me, so unlike Adam, this is actually, I think, my 28th Comic-Con.
Yeah.
Growing up here in San Diego. So, but I remember specific. I don't remember the specific year. Thank you.
But you had to come up to the shrine before.
What's that?
You had to go up to the shrine before.
Yeah. It was up at the Yoga Convention Center before. But so in the, I don't remember specifically what year, but there was one year where they used to do like trailers and premieres of things like that in a room of maybe twice this size, not like Hall H crazy. And there was one year where we all came in and we're used to just hearing talk mostly. They hardly ever showed any video stuff. And the panel was Quentin Tarantino and Oliver Stone. And they said, instead of talking to you about natural born killers, we're just going to premiere it right here. First time it's ever been seen. And the reason why. 94, thank you. Excellent. And he stands up, I don't remember if it was Tarantino or Oliver Stone, but he stands up and says, the reason why is because you guys are our target audience.
Right.
And the crowd just went insane. Like, it was just the coolest thing to hear that Hollywood finally was onto us and recognized that we have power. And it's every year since then, it's just exploded more and more. So that was the tipping point for me.
Anybody else?
Actually, I think for me, kind of like you and your dad, was just recently my girlfriend and I were telling my mom about Orphan Black. And we were trying to explain, no, it's really great, and it sounds clones, and but you'd probably like it. And she was like, oh, yeah. And the next time we talked to her, she was complaining about the fact that she had to pay for season 3 to get it.
That's awesome.
Yeah, I made my mom read Ancillary Justice, and that was like a big victory.
Nice. I think the main thing that I really tip to it that we're really there is the fact that I see the top of everybody's head so often these days.
Yeah.
Because, you know, that's when we've gone to this, because every Dick Tracy, Robert A. Heinlein, there's so many people talked about, you know, having wristwatch radios, which, you know, were there. But I think it's when we finally, you stop having social interaction in public so often, because people were talking by and they weren't on meds or anything, they were just on the phone. You know, so I mean, I think that's when it really sank into me that we are living that future that we'd all dreamed about as kids. It's here, it's right now, and it's mutating every day.
I also want to ask a specific question to Margaret Stohl. You are a woman in the industry, and certainly while there is a resurgence of female-led titles, of female comics creators, of female authors, there aren't a lot of female-driven superhero movies. Right. Women get a lot of pushback in the industry. How is it for a woman in the industry in this resurgence of sci-fi, in this new era? Have you noticed any changes?
Well, I was going to point out that resurgence is only, you know, so far. It'll really be a surge when I'm not the only girl at the table. Really, like that will be the surge I'm looking for. And I look at it, I have no doubt that will happen. I have 3 daughters who are all ass kickers. The Black Widow novel I just did is dedicated to my daughter who channels Romanoff every day and just kicks ass. I have a gay daughter. I have 2 fencing daughters who can literally kick your ass. I mean, that's my life. So my biggest thrill, actually, my moment of when it had changed was when I went into Marvel. I tried not to pass out. I freaked out in front of the mural wall, you know, where they all take pictures. I was like trying not to fangirl. I was fangirling my ass off. And then I sat down with Sana Aminat and talked about Ms. Marvel and got to, like, you know, the fact of a Muslim girl, you know, actual teenage boobless basically hero, like that, I felt like we'd arrived. I mean, I actually like could have cried. So that for me, more of the inclusivity, and I know that's been a really controversial thing in sci-fi this year, but every single person who ever stands up and takes a stand you know, I guess that's really the same thing. If you're standing up, you're taking a stand. So you can tell I'm a very talented writer over here on the left. Maybe that's why there's one girl at the table.
First draft. Yet it's going to be great.
No, but I think every single day in the industry, in sci-fi, as a woman, you are always confronted with the chance to say something or not say something. And I gave a big article, a big interview about this in EW, but... like, for God's sake, say something. If you have the chance to say something, say something, even if it makes people in the room uncomfortable. So, like, thank you for asking the question, because you said something. And I think that's the point. We just keep having those conversations till we don't have to have them anymore.
I think... one of the first women writers that I ever became really fascinated by her work, Devin Grayson, and she was in the business and she lasted for so long, did such a good job on Nightwing and other properties, Batman. Right. I mean, she did a lot of stuff, and then she just kind of was gone. I checked up on her later, and she went and got a straight job, and I was like, why? But she stepped out of it. And Gail Simone now is writing Red Sonja.
Yeah, Gail Simone's awesome.
Yeah, and Gail Simone is just awesome, because I started with her when she's doing the Y'all All Be Sorry columns for CBR. And, I mean, those were a hoot. And then when she got to writing Simpsons and everything else progressed from there. And one of the things you guys miss that you don't notice, you don't see, or you haven't mentioned, women have taken over television. Women writers, if you, like, I watched Justified, you know, it was on for these years and it's gone now. And toward the end, many of the writers were female. Longmire, which is a traditional police procedural kind of thing, most of the writers on that are female. So there's more women working in television, in my opinion, from what I'm seeing.
No, actually not, but
it may be the good television, though.
Yeah, it's definitely the good television.
Can somebody record this portion of the panel and send it to Stephen Moffat?
Yeah.
Okay, good. We're good. Yeah, you know what I'm talking about. Before we move, did anybody else? I don't want to step on anybody.
No.
I also kind of wanted to talk about the abundance of genres that are around today. Mm. Because, I mean, just on this panel alone, we have paranormal romance, we have robot noir, we have military, we have hard sci-fi, we have teen dystopia. I feel like that's part of what's going on right now, is just this proliferation of genres.
Yeah, I mean, it's kind of insane almost, but I think it has to do with, you know, how the audience has just exploded, that you can actually find an audience in these sort of niche genres and do just fine. So it used to be that, you know, just put it on the sci-fi fantasy shelf and see what happens. So I think it's great.
For you.
I was just going to say, you can also write in the most popular genres and have it tank. Like, there's no, like, I think what we're really seeing is a convergence of talented guys like these gents, you know, working on shelves where they're getting a chance to really be read. And it doesn't work if you don't have both of those pieces.
It's also just, as the market gets bigger, you're naturally going to get more subgenres. I mean, if you've only got one restaurant in town, odds are you're only going to get one kind of food. But once you've got 10 restaurants or 20 restaurants, now there's everything. There's a little something no matter what your taste is. So.
And I wonder if, I mean, you were talking, Margaret, earlier about streaming, I wonder if the proliferation of self-publishing platforms has anything to do with this, because now it's much easier to see what people are interested in very specific, granular ways.
Well, I think also there's a lot of, like, it's the, you know, you get, like, the fan fiction, fiction line is blurred, and I actually don't think that's a bad thing, but I love being on Vine and seeing the Marvel recuts of fans who have cut together, you know, Black Widow movies from girl footage that is out there, or putting, you know, and I think that's creation. Like, that's where these guys are going to come from next. So I love the growth of the fandom and the sort of urge towards everyone creating. Even the people who love your world are creating within it.
That's true. We haven't really, I guess we've touched briefly, I think you mentioned the internet. We haven't really touched on the impact of social media on developing fandoms, because... brilliant bolt of insight. It just occurred to me that that's a big part of what's going on today.
Well, it's the reach again. I mean, like we were saying, when you're in high school and there's only three people you know in your town who have the same interest, that's one thing. But thanks to social media, thanks to the internet, you can meet thousands of people in a given day. You can go on Twitter, check one hashtag, and find a million people who have the same interest as you in something. And for reaching fans, for fans reaching you, it's fantastic. So.
And if you are one of the three guys at your high school that likes a certain book, now you two could have found each other, right? Like, and that didn't exist before.
Yeah.
My kid went trick-or-treating in a Homestuck costume and, like, burst into tears when she saw another Homestuck. Like, it was such a meaningful experience in real life. And I think that's what it's the tribe, right? That's why we're all here. You're looking for the tribe. It's easier to get your tribe now.
Yeah. Well, social media, one of the things that social media has brought to us as well is brevity, because my son would watch his social media constantly. I've gotten introduced to more social media through Chandler than anything, because Nostalgia Critic, I don't know if anybody watches Nostalgia Critic, but he does the movie for you in like no time at all. And that's one of the things I see, is they're very short. And now Tor is developing a novella program for people that don't have time to read a complete book, because I teach, and then during, it's really true, it happens as you get older. I get very busy, and so I have to actually plan my reading time before it just happened. And now you have to take this time. And now with fan-based things and self-pub things, we get short novellas. I can sit down with one of those. When I first started writing books, usually popular stuff, mysteries and things like that, 50,000 words. You can read that in a night or two. And when you get to 80,000 and 90,000, or you know, the fantasy novels is even more, it takes a lot longer. It's a bigger commitment. Game of Thrones, I've tried four times now to try to read it. And I'm ADHD, so I get distracted, and then I come back a week later, and I go, I don't remember who these people are, and I don't think I ever cared. So.
Preach. Preach. Thank you.
It's actually just a point about, someone mentioned self-publishing. Mm-hmm. I think not just in self-publishing and regular publishing, there seems to be, to me, this almost like a relaxation where creators and the audiences are more happy to write and mix genres within science fiction. Yeah. You know, mm-hmm. If you like science fiction with science, then there's plenty of that. If you like science fiction, which is just kind of crazy fantasy stuff, then that's also part of it. And I don't know, over the last maybe 10 years, there seems to be such a broadening of that. You know, the stuff that I write is never straight science fiction. Whereas, you know, probably earlier, I really would have had to have gone down a particular genre of thing. It's probably the same with all of us, I think.
Did anybody else? I was going to. I think we have time for one last question to the panel before we throw to the audience. And one of the things that I was thinking about when I was preparing for this is we've won, now what? You know, I think any writer of military sci-fi can tell you that you have to win the peace as much as you have to win the war. So what do people want to see going forward? What do you hope for the field? What do you want to see come into it? If we're talking about books we loved as children, I want to see somebody make a movie out of Tamora Pierce's Song of the Lioness, but maybe that's a little niche-y.
I'm down with you.
But what do you want to see going forward for the field and for the fans?
I want to see faces that look like the readers. I want to see women and girls. I want to see people who aren't white and different experiences. Yeah. And I want that not to be a superficial thing, but a sort of real thing.
Yeah, I agree in that regard. My brother and I and our company recently started talking with Ursula K. Le Guin about possibly doing Wizard of Earthsea, doing a
oh, that would be so sweet.
Please,
please do that.
Pretty please.
Which,
yes,
and,
please.
She, I don't think I'd be talking out of school to say that she was disappointed with the television version they did a while ago. In part because she had envisioned, you know, a copper-skinned hero and people of all different hues as populating Earthsea, There's to me, what militates against that is this sense that science fiction films have to be so big and so spectacular, that hundreds of millions of dollars are spent, and that an inherent caution is then the sort of the rule of the day, which is why we're seeing so many reboots. I should talk because I've been working on a Star Wars movie, but I don't. That escapes my. My dislike of previously existing intellectual property somehow. And the result of the tremendous expense, that's something else I would like to see. I would like to see, you know, I was really amazed by the CG in Game of Thrones this year. And I thought, well, okay, if the prices come down enough, then we could be looking at all sorts of different kinds of science fiction and fantasy getting out there. And also, if people get a little more comfortable with the notion that science fiction isn't just about tentpoles and giant things, but that it's about conceptualizing the ways that life could be. Yeah, I think that there are some really heartening examples of that this year. I think Ex Machina was, I mean, although it had amazing effects, it didn't rely purely on the effects.
Yeah.
I would like to see it infiltrate more and more into just sort of everyday productions rather than just gigantic stuff.
That's a great point. I have hands going up, so it might be time to, unless anybody else has a parting thought there, we might be time to throw to the audience for some questions. Yes? Okay. I saw you. You had your hand up. Speak up.
You've spoken a lot about various kinds of transmedia, the connection of movies and television and books and stuff. One thing that you haven't mentioned is role-playing games and the influence of that. I understand The Expanse was originally two traveler games.
Yep, that's right. Yeah.
There are real-world people who played those characters in his world first. What are your experiences with role-playing games and more collaborative storytelling that helped you become the storyteller you are now?
Did everyone hear the question, by the way? Or?
I'd like to jump in because I don't think we've won. I don't think we've won until every little boy and girl feels okay about saying they play Dungeons and Dragons.
Yes. And yes.
You know, that was huge for me, more than video games, because video games were kind of in their infancy when I was getting going. But Dungeons and Dragons was Dungeons and Dragons were a very big deal for me and taught me a lot about. Storytelling, and really fired my imagination and led me to read things I wouldn't otherwise have read, and think about things I wouldn't otherwise have thought about. Hugely important. It's not something I do anymore, which I suppose is kind of sad.
There is a regular game in my neighborhood, so if you ever need a hookup, the Dungeon Master's 16, but he's awesome.
Okay. Excellent.
I'm serious.
Are we all invited?
Yeah, okay. You're all invited. Excellent. After this, my place.
I see some more hands going up. You look very eager right there.
Yeah, I was just curious with the Martian coming out in the popularity of the book and in NASA's focus. I mean, it's a little closer to home. It's not way out there. It's a galaxy far, far away. But do you see some emphasis that we're going to pay attention to the next steps, the next places, the next level of future that you were talking about? Seems like it's coming a little bit closer to those problems we have on Earth, or maybe talking back over to Mars or beyond, kind of getting beyond our own world.
Sometimes everyone does get on board with that. I've had pushback. I worked on a game called Earth and Beyond briefly, and people didn't like, you know, what one of the things that I liked about it was that it was set in the known universe. And it turns out a lot of times people prefer the unknown universe. You can draw safer, you know, you can explore relevant issues more safely. So it's kind of interesting. Sometimes real is uncomfortable.
Well, they're talking about going to Mars, but they're not talking about coming back. It's a one-way trip right now. A lot of people seem like they're on board with that. But I don't know that we're really going to be looking at space until we privatize it more than what we have now, because we need to get away from the government restrictions, and everybody's worried about the budgets and everything like that. And it's going to take somebody. Ben Boba has written about financiers that went out and did this themselves. And I think if we privatize space in there somewhere, I think it'll work better.
You think private industry is not going to be worried about a budget?
Well, they're going to be worried about a budget, but you got, you know, like Virgin Enterprises, they do just about everything. So you got a guy and a dream, and if you all of a sudden start making money at it, yeah. Conventions. Who would have told you? The guy that first put on the conventions and said, oh, yeah, build a convention, they'll come. You know, and some conventions have died out over the years, and some have stayed. So who would have ever thought you could have made money off of something like this? So...
In the blue stripes back there, you've had your hand up. Must be tired.
Who would you pick to write the screenplay for Foundation?
And is it you? That should be the next question. Because I have a hot script in my back pocket.
I was going to say me too.
Probably everyone in this room has good enough headcanon that they could do it.
And for free. Well, maybe not these guys.
Right.
There was very little on the screen at that time, but how much of that is the screen, the sci-fi that's on the screen? How many people are reading? Are there more people reading sci-fi now?
You have to remember everything comes from the written word. Even if it becomes a television show first, it's somebody sat down and came up with an idea. So, you know, just don't ever...
Even reality television.
Yeah, even reality television.
Well, I can...
Yeah.
And I think a lot of that, like I still feel like...
We're dreamers.
I read a lot of these books before they became part of the screen. And so to me, I ask people, did you ever read the book? Because there's so much more in the book.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so I'm just wondering, though, are people reading the book?
They are.
Yeah,
they are.
I think from what I've read, there are more, even though they keep talking about doom for publishers and everything else, the reports I'm reading are there more people are reading more all the time.
Yes.
You know, it's getting harder to track with electronic media, you know, social media and stuff like that, because news, Chandler and I, you know, people keep talking about newspapers, and Chandler goes to one source, or two or three sources, I guess, now, and I usually hit MSN.com and for news and stuff, and then I follow stuff up on scientific things, but everything comes from the written word. And it's somebody that's actually fearless enough to put their dreams down on paper, and then somebody else will pick that flag up and go, yeah, I want to see this. So
I can also say anecdotally, we did some audience research a couple of years ago for NPR, for our website, and the thing that our audience wanted was more science fiction, which was great for me. I think we can do two more quick questions. So you and you have both been waving eagerly.
Mm-hmm. And Mr. Odom mentioned what was my first thought, which was those wonderful Heinlein juveniles.
Right.
Planet of the Rolling Stones. What do you think the difference is between YA then and now? And why is it getting more audience, more acceptance? Is it a question of quality or just circumstances?
Well, you guys can jump
in.
I
would actually say I think one of the biggest things is that the two big comic book manufacturers, Marvel and DC, started aiming at a much higher age group. I think there's always been a huge young adult market. It's just that 30, 40 years ago, that was Marvel, that was DC.
Right.
Now Marvel and DC are aiming at mid-20s, mid-30s. And so naturally that there was a vacuum, and it just filled up with Harry Potter and, you know, the Spiderwick Chronicles and dozens of other things. So there's always been a huge young adult market. It's just what we're filling it with has changed.
Yeah, we wouldn't have called it a young adult market. We didn't have a specific, there wasn't like teen specific, well, I mean, Heinlein Juvenile, that's right, but there wasn't like a teen specific shelf previously. That was the fight.
One of the big things that's changed is it's no longer just a Y market, because when I was a kid, my parents did not read, you know, mostly anything, but never what I was reading. And we have parents now, they're teenagers or middle graders, who are sharing their books, and parents who are willing to read them. And so then all of a sudden you have a conversation. Chandler and I swap books and stuff all the time.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that's been one of the biggest changes, is that we have a shared world with our children now.
I think, Andrew, is it 80% of YAs read by adults? Like there's some 80% number, I don't remember. Yeah. Okay, so an associate publisher over here is saying that there is a number thrown around that is huge, that YA books are read almost equally by adults and teens. And as you're saying, together, you know, in that kind of conversation. And I have found that to be true as well. And Andrew is saying the ebook was part of what made that accessible. And also for adults, because no one's judging your book cover, right? It's like you could go the porn direction or you could go juvenile. Either way, no one can see.
So we have 5 minutes left, I've been informed. You, sir, but quickly.
So 40 years ago, it was difficult to get all of this entertainment we're talking about. I mean, if you went to see Silent Running, you had to come to a con to
Right. Yeah. You can make it work.
Yeah, let's not end on a downer here.
I think for me that a lot of this stuff is exploring these real-world problems that we have in a way that is accessible and gets people talking about it when they maybe don't even realize they're talking about it. And if that gets people thinking about it, then when they get to the point where they can start tackling those problems, they'll have a better understanding of them.
Yeah, I think we're always going for truth, right? I would say we're always looking for an emotional truth or the truth of whatever's in the book, so we don't see them as so totally separate.
You don't think you're just sitting home and watching all this TV?
Well, I am, but I don't know what they're doing, per se.
I'm very sorry to eager beavers that have their hands up. We are out of time, but I would like to thank you to the wonderful panelists and the wonderful audience.